Hello, my name is Rodrigo, and I am a clinical psychology grad student, and today I wanted to talk to you all about the most meaningful and most difficult experience I've had in my journey studying psychology. That experience is in my time volunteering at a crisis center and picking up the phone for the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline, which I'm going to be referring to that as the NSPL, just to make it shorter. So first, I am going to explain what these places are, who can call a crisis center, and who can call the NSPL, because there are different things. And I'm going to talk about, I'm also going to talk about two misconceptions, two very damaging misconceptions, and you'll see why in a second. Then I'm going to talk about how I started working there and my experience. I just wanted to start in this kind of weird order, because I know that statistically more people are going to watch like the start of the video, and the misconceptions are much more important than my story. My story is just an individual story, and it's just like fun and things like that. So let's get started. I'm going to read the definition of what crisis center is straight from the source. I'm going to attach the link in the description below from the webpage that I got this from. That webpage also has the maps of all the crisis centers in the US. It has one big map. You can find the number and name of the crisis centers near you. What is a crisis center? A crisis center is a resource for individuals going through mental health crisis. They provide mental health services and emotional support for their state or local communities. That part is super important, and that's one of the misconceptions, that people can only call crisis centers when they are in a crisis. I know, it's dumb, because the name is crisis center, but I hope they change that name too, because listen to the definition again. They provide mental health services and emotional support, so it's not only for crisis. We are trained in aiding in so many different things, from just listening to people. Maybe a person just had a bad day, doesn't want to talk to it about their friends or their family, just wants to talk to like a professional, let's say, and a counselor. They call us and we listen, even if it's about, oh, today I had a fight with my best friend, or I'm feeling really anxious, or I'm feeling very sad, maybe depressed. You can call a crisis center for whatever reason. You can ask them, hey, so I'm feeling this way, or I'm going through this, can I talk to you? And they're going to say, yes, you can talk to us, because that's how we're trained, and that's what we do. We try to help. So that's a crisis center. The other thing is the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline. That one, yes, you call when you have been suicidal, are suicidal, know someone that is suicidal, and you want to learn how you can help, you are very depressed, or yes, maybe a bigger crisis. That's when you call the NSPL. There are two separate numbers. and you're gonna be able to find all of this information in the description below, so don't worry. Now, let me keep going. Your local crisis center usually serves your entire community, often 24/7 and free of charge. These centers also connect callers to providers in their community that can support their needs. That last part, connecting callers to providers in the community, that was a huge part of our training. And our training is long. Oh my goodness. The place I worked at, Center Helps, it's the longest volunteer training in the United States. So that says something. And a big part of it was learning how to connect people to, maybe the crisis was that someone doesn't have food, you know, doesn't have a bed to sleep on. We need to be able to look for resources on our database and try to connect those people with those resources. We have a huge database, so if you have any concern of that sort, if it's food, shelter, maybe you have a kid that you need some money for a new notebook or for a book bag, you call a crisis center and you ask. Our databases are huge. I'm saying our, I don't volunteer there anymore. I moved to a different place, as in like a different city in the US. But yes, you call them and they have the database and you ask them, because they're so nice, so sweet, and they are trained. So yes. The other thing is, the next part of the definition. Crisis centers answer calls for the lifeline, as well as local helplines. So that's what I was saying about the NSPL is just a phone number that gets routed to crisis centers. And the crisis centers are just, it's just the place itself, it's just, it's a different number. And offer resources such as text, chat, or mobile services. That's really cool. You can even just on your laptop, like chat with them if you don't want to call anyone. If you don't want to be, if you're scared someone's gonna hear you, you can text them. If you, yeah, for whatever reason, if you have a phone or anything, you can text them. Again, I'm going to put all of that information in the description below. Never be scared, even if you're feeling that, oh, maybe this is not that urgent. We get those calls, and we are very happy that people ask and just call, because it's so damaging. Here's the part that's damaging. I'm just gonna say it now. It breaks my heart, because I've had close friends and very, very important people to me that have been in crisis, and they tell me, hey, but I didn't want to call because I feel like I wasn't in enough of a crisis, you know, or I wasn't suicidal, or I wasn't suicidal enough. I've heard those things so many times, and it's so sad. So just please just call if you need to and ask, and You'll see the reaction that you'll get. Please don't, you know, be afraid to call. Thank you. Okay, I'm gonna continue. Crisis centers also provide training and educational resources on suicide prevention and mental wellness. This is, again, if you want some information, not for you, but for someone else, and you want to try to help someone else and learn how you can help someone else, then you can call them. You can call a crisis center, or you can call the NSPL if it's about someone that's suicidal or has been suicidal, or someone that's, yeah, a bit more of a behavior crisis. All of the services that crisis centers offers strengthens their local community and the state as a whole. Okay, that's the definition. Let me just reiterate. In the description below, I'm gonna put the webpage where you can find the map with all the crisis centers and their numbers. And that's one thing. It's one place where you can call whenever you want, for whatever reason you want, and ask them if you can talk to them about that. And you'll see that they say yes. But the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline is the other number that I'm going to attach below. So, yes. Now, I'm already through with the first misconception that to call a crisis center you need to be in crisis or need to be going through something horrible. Not true. The second misconception is, if I call a crisis center or the NSPL, I'm going to take someone's place and someone else is not going to be able to talk to someone and they might need it more. That's a huge misconception, because first, the NSPL is designed in a specific way so that every caller, every call goes to a different center, to a different place, and there are so many centers in the US, and besides so many people that can answer a phone call from the NSPL. So it's designed so that can never happen for the NSPL. And for crisis centers, there's usually more than one people, and if there is more, like a lot of people and a lot of calls, you can get routed to other places, or it's just not a thing that you should worry about, because those places think about those things and are designed so that you can't take anyone else's place. So just call if you need to, please. Okay, now, with all that being said, let me start telling a bit of my story. Stretch real quick. Okay. So, for me, everything started. I was walking down a hallway in my university, and I saw this like a pamphlet, and it said, you know, you wanna work and help like suicidal clients through the NSPL. And my first reaction was like, I took it so I could think about it, and I was close to like not giving them a call, because I was working as an auxiliary officer like for the university police, and I had a lot of things going on. But I just thought about it, and what could be better than that? You know, they need people. And before I forget, say that you can also call a crisis center if you want to volunteer. You can ask them if they have volunteering opportunities or what you can do to help. You call the same number that you would call if you were calling for to talk, for a crisis, for resources. So that's a really cool thing. You can call it if you're interested in volunteering, and you don't have to be, at least for Center Helps, the one in Pennsylvania. You don't need a bachelor's. Just need to be, I think, doing have some coursework in university. I'm not even sure if that's the requirement, but they change them and update them from time to time, so you have to call them. But yeah, just wanted to say that. So yeah, I ended up calling, got an interview, and oh my goodness, the interview was so scary. It was so scary. What they do is they like you walk up some stairs and open a door, and there's like 20 people, 20 volunteers, 20 people that work there and have worked there for a while, just there staring at you, and they say, "Hello, ready to start the interview," and you start. They try to, of course, make you a bit nervous. They're trying to see how you work under stress, and at the end, what you have to do is a fake, like a mock phone call with someone or some of the people that already work there. And my fake call was really hard. It was about like if a mom is having like a psychotic break and her baby is like dying, and she doesn't want to give the baby meds because she thinks that they are against her religion. So that's the context I have, and here I am, never worked for something big like psychological like that, and you have to get your hand into like this to pretend that you're on the call. I'm staring at the other volunteer, and I'm like just trying to figure things out, you know, and I don't even remember what I ended up doing. I think I just tried calling the police or tried telling her, like tried to convince her that it was okay to give the baby medication, but it was just a very scary experience. But it ended up working out well, because well, I got in. And now, my favorite part of the video, the people that work there. Once I got in and started working, I noticed something I've never seen before. Just everyone working there is just there because they want to volunteer and try to help people get through difficult situations. So they were just the kindest people and the most empathetic people I have ever met. And everyone fed off of each other's energy. It really was beautiful. It was, you could imagine that crisis centers are dark, you know, because the topics are very heavy and it's like, oh no, you know, what a heavy place. But no, it's the opposite. To combat that heaviness and that darkness that crisis brings, or that, you know, that comes with doing emotional support, also you need to have the other side, which is the light, the people that can dive with the other person into darkness and come back up with them, you know. So you have the dark of the situation and you have the light in the volunteers, and that's why it's so beautiful and it's such a good atmosphere. So yeah, it's just again my favorite place in the world, and the only thing I would match it to of that community, it's to the ASMR community, which of course they're known for being lovely and kind and empathetic. So those are the two communities that I cherish the most. Now, I ended up volunteering there for a lot of hours, a lot of calls. Of course, some better than others, but just so you get an idea, a lot of the people would call because they or the other didn't have friends and they didn't trust their family, or they had just had a big fight with their family, or they never had like a vulnerable interaction with anyone, or a compassionate interaction. So those are the calls for emotional support that we get the most, just people that needed a little bit of love and kindness and needed to be listened to instead of just telling them what to do, you know. So most of the times the calls were very gratifying because you get to talk to compassion, and the people working there are very compassionate, so it's just natural, and things usually go very well. And as for the NSPL, when we get calls from the lifeline, of course that varies a bit more, but it's mostly people that are in the worst moment, the moments where like they think that everything is horrible, everything has been horrible, and everything will be horrible, and that it's not worth it, you know, to go through all those horrible things, to keep living horrible things. That's the mentality at the moment. That's usually not their baseline. I don't think I've ever got a call from someone that was their regular. Of course, a lot of people think that my life isn't like great and it's pretty horrible, but I'm talking about the depths that make you want to like take your own life and die by suicide, you know? So the important thing there was listening. And listening, and listening some more, reflecting their feelings, trying to, I can do a video later about how to reflect feelings and feeling reflections. It's a really, really good tool to try to help people, and most of the times they just talk themselves out of that horrible hole that they're in, and they remember the reason why they were, you know, still existing, what gave them meaning, if it was the good things that they could do with their career, if it was their iPad. One of the most beautiful ones is when they remember that their meaning was their niece, their son, their daughter, their friend, their people that stay alive just because they want to be good for those friends. So meaning doesn't have to be something huge, it can be something small like that. It's so strong that it just pulls them back out of that horrible hell that they have been going through, and then they stabilize, and that's when we can start working a bit more on, hey, what else, you know, what other things could you do, who else could you reach out, would you be interested in long-term therapy, because the NSPL and crisis centers cannot be used as long-term therapy. So we try to connect them with professionals that do long-term therapy. So that's usually how those calls go. I could go into more detail in other videos, but I don't want to talk too much about it right now, because I'm talking about a lot of topics and a broad perspective. So that's basically my experience and volunteering in those places, working with those beautiful people, and learning that that's something I want to dedicate my life to. And on the fall, I'm going to start working at a psychiatric center for kids and teenagers. So you could imagine, of course, a lot of those cases, especially in the teenagers, it's teens that either are going through a really rough patch and think that suicide is the best option for them, or teens that are just going through really hard things and trauma and PTSD, and maybe it's very big anxiety or clinical depression. And so I'm getting ready for that, to try to help those people that need it the most, that are struggling as I could never imagine. And yeah, so I'm very passionate about these topics, and I would love to do more videos about it, but first I'm gonna, you know, I just wanna see if more people wanna hear about these things. I know it can be a bit triggering, and lastly, another thing that I wanted to say is that I don't intend on only talking about like heavy topics or making every video 100% about psychology. For example, my next video I'm thinking of doing like extracting like harsh emotions and harsh feelings, you know, like the picking and plucking and things like that. Combine that with a little bit of cognitive behavioral therapy, a little some comments and some things like that, but nothing like this, just a ramble about my experience and those things. So I'm gonna try to combine and try to find a good balance between pure psychology and ASMR and all those things. So yeah, I'm happy to hear some feedback as to what you all want to hear. And no matter what, I'm gonna keep doing, of course, from time to time, my more psychology videos, because I think they're important. But I really appreciate, like, that I've gotten a lot of messages, supportive messages, that they're glad that there's someone doing these types of videos. And yeah, I'm just so excited to start. Starting this channel, and very excited to interact with you all and trying to, I don't know, and grow with you all. And yeah, I hope you learned something from this video, or if not, that you at least got a bit relaxed. And yeah, thank you. And if you're going to sleep, good night. And if you're watching this in the day, I hope you have a good learning day.